The advice and opinions expressed by the host of Autism Live and her guests are meant solely as suggestion and should not be in any way construed as child-specific advice. The Center for Autism and Related Disorders advises working with a board-certified behavior analyst who has experience with autism before starting any intensive behavioral intervention. Any choices you make in determining your child's treatment are completely at your own discretion.
Good morning and welcome to Autism Live. I'm Shannon Penrod, and we're webcasting to you live from the Center for Autism and Related Disorders headquarters in Tarzana, California. So thrilled to be here with you on this Wednesday morning. We've got an incredible show planned for you, and we're going to get to that in just a minute. I want to remind all of you that if you were watching the show yesterday, you saw Yolanda Baker on the show. She is the author of this amazing book, Bite Your Bills, Cutting Medical Costs for the Disabled, How I Got $28,000 Back in Medical Expenses. She was on the show yesterday, and she is giving free webinars this week. If you're getting ready to do your taxes and you would like some help and support figuring out what is deductible if you've got a child on the autism spectrum, great resource, and she is giving those webinars for free. So you can go to biteyourbills.com, sign up for those free webinars, and check it out. Really an amazing resource for information. I want to remind all of you that this entire show is meant to be interactive and that there are lots of different ways that you can participate. Emily just cycled through some of the different ways you can get a hold of us. But the only way you can watch us live is at www.autism-live.com. When you go there, you will see a feature. It's our live feature. It says, questions we're answering right now. Put your cursor there, type away, hit enter, and it shows up magically right here on my screen. You have the opportunity to ask questions of the amazing guests that we have here in the show, not the least of which is Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh, who's going to be joining us in just a second for Ask Dr. Doreen. So we want to encourage you to log on now, and really all you have to do to log on is to go to that site, www.autism-live.com. There's nothing else you have to do. You don't have to put in your personal information. There is no request for a credit card. It's all free. And we can have a wonderful opportunity to ask a true expert in the field of autism questions, your questions, in real time. If you are just joining us this week and this is your first show this week, you might be noticing that I have a different haircut. On Monday, to kick off Compassion in Action, we started it here and I shaved my head. We're asking everyone to do something nice for someone else during this month of autism awareness. And I chose to have my head shaved to support a young dad who is battling cancer. And we did that on Monday, and I'm enjoying the breeze, as we said that I would. And so don't adjust your computer. This is what it is. And I have to say, it's been a lovely, lovely experience. All right, without further ado, it is time for Ask Dr. Doreen.
Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh is the
Dr. Doreen is an expert in autism.
Doreen Granpeesheh.
Dr. Granpeesheh.
Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh.
Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh is a visionary in the field of autism, and now you get to ask her questions on Ask Dr. Doreen. Welcome to Ask Dr. Doreen. Our special guest this morning on this very special day is Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh. Thank
Good
you
morning.
For being here.
It's a pleasure. Good morning.
Can I disclose what today is?
Yes, please.
It is Dr. Doreen's birthday. It is a very
a
special
birthday,
a big birthday. And so thrilled. I said, how dedicated are you that you came in this morning to ask parents questions, answer for parents so that they could ask questions and have you answer them?
Oh, no, absolutely.
On your birthday morning. Just an amazing woman. I have to start out by saying, you are my hero.
Oh, you're so kind.
Have to say, the difference that you have made in my life and so many people who I know and treasure in their lives, the difference that you make in our kids' lives.
Thank you.
I could sit here and weep.
No, don't. Now you're going to make me emotional, too.
I'll get all
verklempt. I honestly think that I'm just extremely blessed and lucky to have been put in this situation that I have for my life, that I can help people, you know, so it's really wonderful.
And you do. And I have to say, I have said this before behind your back when you weren't in the room, but, you know, there are very few people that you meet in your life that you walk away and say that person is the real deal, and that they keep disclosing to you that they are the real deal. And I can tell you with all sincerity that you are
the real deal. Thank you so much.
And you've shown that to me over and over and over again, how caring and compassionate she is toward our children.
Thank you.
You are a visionary in this field, and thrilled to have you here. I want to remind everybody that they can be asking you questions this morning. And we always like to remind everyone that though you answer questions, you don't answer child-specific questions for a very good reason. There's not enough information that you can get via a question on the internet to really do justice to the individual child or the individual adult that you're answering the question about.
Yeah, that's very important. We really want people to realize that we're just answering as in general form, and we can't really go into too much detail. We don't know the individuals involved.
Yes. But aside from that, I will say I learned so much when you answer questions. The information that you give, it gives us choices as parents. I always leave here and think, okay, I have new things to think about, avenues to pursue. So we thank you for that time. We're already getting questions coming in on the live feature, and if you guys want to ask your questions, please go ahead. Okay, the first one, two questions regarding stimming. Mm-hmm. Can hand flapping be replaced with a different behavior, or does it stem from diet or yeast? And then also, Shannon, I'm wondering if any of your son's symptoms got better with diet changes. I know I've heard you do GFCF, but you are yeast, sugar-free, or something similar. It seems hard to tell what it is. What is from yeast and what is behavior issue in my son? Thank you for all you guys do. So first question, can hand flapping be replaced with a different behavior, or does it stem from diet or yeast?
So that's a really good question, actually. And when we talk about stimming, that's short for self-stimulatory behavior. And hand flapping is an interesting one. When you want to try to reduce hand flapping, it's one of the behaviors that you just block. Mm-hmm. So basically, typically what we do is we will give the child something to do that it doesn't allow them to hand flap. And that would be, you know, this is kind of the same thing as teachers tell you in the classroom, just put your hands in your pocket or sit on your hands, you know. So it's just, that's the reason. It's to block the behavior. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, one of my children who used to hand flap quite a bit, actually, and he used to not only hand flap, but he would take objects and do this with them, which a lot of our kids do as well. And later, he became an amazing drum player. Mm. Yeah, and so that was sort of, I guess, if anything, a replacement type behavior, because it was the same kind of motion.
Yeah.
Right. But generally, there isn't anything that's appropriate other than hitting the drums that looks like hand flapping. Yeah. So typically, we try to just block it.
Mm-hmm. It's an amazing thing. Jem did hand flap in the beginning. It very quickly went away as we started ABA, and I don't even remember them blocking it, which is a very funny thing to me. But I did share on the show the other day that I was cutting his fingernails the other day, because I'm starting to transition into him considering it, but I was still doing it. And he just had ants in his pants. And so he said, can I do this? And we had a conversation about it. I said, you used to do that all the time. Why did you do that? And he said, it looks interesting. And he said, look at it. When you do this, it's kind of cool looking. You know what I mean?
That's interesting.
And I
love the stuff we learn from the kids. I love it. It's so great.
And how grateful I am at this point in my life that I can ask him those things, because when he was three, if you had asked me what I would have given to have been able to ask him that question and gotten that answer, I would have given you everything.
It's an amazing answer, actually.
So, and I've heard other parents have asked their kids, and they said, you know, because I feel like I'm a bird and I want to fly away. I mean, I think kids have different answers for it, but it did go away for Jem, and it was a very positive thing that it went away when it did, because it helped him to interact with other kids. It was something that was preventing it.
That's right. It just, I guess, made him look different in some ways. But I think a lot of kids do hand flapping, particularly when they're excited.
Yeah.
So they'll, you know, get up, jump up and down and perhaps do that. And I think so, in some ways, it's just sort of a behavior that comes with excitement. And some kids do it when they're bored. So I think what happens over the course of therapy, and like with Jem, where it goes away, is that the child is actually occupied using their hands in other ways.
Yeah.
And then it'll go away. But, you know, you notice that even with us, we do use our hands when we speak. And so it's, our hands are a part of like our expressive behavior. So as long as it doesn't separate them, as you mentioned, I think it's important to get rid of it when it does produce, you know, make them look odd with their peers.
Absolutely.
And then in terms of whether or not the diet helps that, I don't know that I've seen a direct connection. Obviously, things like sugar or certain food colorings and so on will make the child typically more hyperactive. And so if you are more hyperactive, you're more likely to become anxious or just agitated or do those types of things. So it's kind of like you're stimulated. So you'll do physical motion type behaviors more. But other than that, I think the benefits of the diet are more mental.
Yeah.
I think you just wake up more, pay better attention, are able to focus, have better memory, all of those types of things are mainly the things that go with the diet. And I think the parent was kind of interested in your experience of the diet as well. And there's many different diets, obviously.
Absolutely. And we've tried a lot of them, and I'm actually considering looking at, we've changed, because Julie Matthews was on the show a couple of weeks ago with you, and she said a couple of things that I thought, you know, I need to go back and tweak a couple of things.
Yeah.
We started out, it was very interesting how we came to the diets, that while we were waiting to get our funding through the regional center, I kept saying to everyone, what can I be doing in this time? I as soon as I knew and we had the diagnosis of autism, and everybody was talking about early intervention, you got to start right this minute.
Right.
And it felt like this really strange, cruel world, because I said, okay, then let's start today. And everybody went, oh, fill out this paperwork and wait 3 months.
I know, it's terrible.
And you know, it was just, it's a hurry up and wait kind of thing. So I kept saying to everybody, what can I do in the meantime? Well, now I would tell people, go on IBT and do a bunch of trainings and get yourself caught up to speed and get on
That's true.
But I didn't have that in that moment because you were working on that and I didn't know you yet.
Right.
And but I said to one person, I said, what can I be doing? Please tell me something I can be doing, because you feel like you're going to jump out of your skin. And she said, well, you know, there's that diet. And I said, what is it? And she said, the gluten-free diet. I didn't even know what gluten was, but here's the irony. I'm allergic to wheat. But I didn't know what gluten was. Probably because I'm allergic to wheat, it just wasn't part of my vocabulary. And I said, what are you talking? What's gluten? And she said, oh, it's wheat. And to me, because I'm allergic to wheat, I thought, okay, this is something I can do. So we started gluten-free then, and we saw a huge difference.
Yes.
In our child. And that isn't the case in every child, but in our child, we saw a huge difference. So then I started Googling gluten-free diet autism, and I saw gluten-free casein-free.
Right.
So then we added the casein to it, and oh my goodness, we were in a different ballpark already.
Right.
And we had such tremendous progress as we were working towards starting ABA. And then we hit a little bit of a wall where we weren't seeing any more progress beyond that. And I saw in my child's diet that all he wanted to eat was potatoes. So then we went to the next thing. And for a very brief period of time, literally 28 days, we were on the specific carbohydrate diet, but and we were being monitored daily by a doctor, but he went into ketosis very quickly, and that was not helpful. So, but we took out a bunch of other things because we looked at the Feingold diet, so we took out tomatoes and potatoes were out, and grapes and apples and a whole bunch of other things. We took yeast out. There was no sugar in his diet, and then over the years, we've added things back in. So he does have tomatoes, and he does have potatoes. We very closely monitor his intake of fruit sugar, but there is no sugar in his diet. Mm-hmm. And for a while, we very severely limited fruit. If you ask my child what would he like for a treat, other kids would say a piece of candy. That doesn't even enter my child's realm of understanding. But he'll say, can I have a cutie, a little cutie orange? And that's a big treat for him. But if I were to give him a bunch of cuties, even all these years later, he would act like a drunk person.
Really?
Very quickly.
Amazing.
And I think I need to go back and do some other work with him biomedically to see if we can tilt that balance so that that isn't the case.
Yeah, that would be very important. I mean, I think we all should. I actually even think sometimes that I should be doing the same thing, not just with my kids, but with myself. And I think it's important to look at the things that we're sensitive to in our diet.
Yes.
And these days, I mean, pretty much, as you know, my belief is that most of what we eat is unhealthy anyway. Yeah. I always feel better when I'm not eating at all, if I'm just doing, you know, which is also a diet called the elemental diet, where you're just drinking shakes, you know, protein and vitamin shakes.
Wow.
But mainly, and that a lot of our kids are on that, who are very, very prone to GI disorders. So some of the gastroenterologists will place our kids on the elemental diet as well, which is really just nutrients in liquid form.
I'm very interested because this sounds like something that, you know, we might have to consider at some point to get him completely cleaned out.
Yes. The thing is, though, it's first of all long-term, and then coming off of it is a very, very gradual process. Mm-hmm. And it's difficult, obviously, for kids. And, you know, he will lose weight on it. That's okay. The other thing. But having said that, it's very important to tell parents that the various diets are not necessary for everyone.
Exactly.
But at the same time, I always suggest that you start with looking at dietary issues with your kids, because you really want the child to be at his or her healthiest, let's say. Diet often will affect our kids' sleep patterns, and then our kids are not sleeping, and on top of that, now we're trying to teach them stuff, and they're just not able to. But also, diet, as I said, like, some of our kids, that we can control their seizures with diet.
Yeah.
Some of our kids, like, night and day reaction with the right foods. Some of the kids have come in with very serious rashes, which are mostly fungal, and you can get rid of those with diet. These are extremely important things.
Yeah.
So seeing a nutritionist, figuring out the diet that's right for your child, and then doing it is one of the biggest impacts you can have.
Absolutely. And I have to say, even personally, was it 2 weeks ago today that I got back my allergy test results, and they were telling me that I'm allergic now to milk and bananas.
Really?
And I pretty much live on yogurt.
Amazing.
And they said, it's time to stop. You must be having physical reactions to this because you're very allergic to not only cow's milk, but goat's milk also. And, And it has been an interesting couple of weeks for me going off of it. You know, had a little bit of a rebound.
Yes, sure.
I have a new appreciation for what it's like when our kids get taken off of these things.
Yes.
And I'm finally starting to feel differently.
Mm-hmm.
And it's amazing.
Yes.
It is like somebody pulling back another curtain and you go, wow, look at all the great things happening.
And it took, about 2 weeks or so to adjust
weeks.
To it? Yeah, it's hard.
2 weeks where I said, oh, I thought I was going to feel better.
Yeah.
And I didn't. I felt
and
worse.
That's just casein, for instance,
yes,
or milk. But with gluten, it takes even longer.
Yeah. And I don't eat gluten because I happen to be allergic to wheat. So now I am officially GFCF probably for the rest of my life.
That's amazing.
Not as much fun as I thought. I'm familiar with the diet, but I'm also a mostly vegetarian on top of that, where my son is not. So it's been an interesting couple of weeks sorting it out, but I do feel better. And feeling better, we talk about this on the show all the time, is pretty much everything.
Yeah.
After that, you know, everything, if you don't have your health, what do you have?
That's right.
And if we expect our kids to be, you know, their highest, most productive, reach their highest possibilities, then getting them healthy has to be high on the list, if not the top thing.
That's right. And it is, you know, absolutely something you can do before you start a behavioral program or during or whatever,
And we've got a question that's coming up about, you know, what to do if you haven't been able to start services. But it is interesting to me now that I get asked that question a lot about what should I be doing right now? Mm-hmm. And I always tell people, start the process of getting ABA because it's a process. Mm-hmm. It's, I think a lot of places are getting it honed, you know, funding sources are getting it a little bit easier as time goes by, but it's still a process to get that started. And then while you're waiting, get as educated as you can, and now you've made it so much easier. As we talked about, iBehavioralTraining.com. You can go there and get educated very inexpensively. It's such a gift.
Yeah, I love the trainings on there. I mean, they're just so friendly and easy, and the team that our IBT group of clinicians, senior clinicians who've been doing this for a very long time, they're working real hard. They're putting together a lot of new ones are being uploaded continuously. And now they just, I don't know, fixed the technology so that you can play all the modules on your iPad, iPhone, devices.
Yeah, that's great.
So it is. I think it's fabulous. I mean, that means anywhere you are, you're waiting anywhere, you know, in a doctor's office or here or there, you could actually be looking at the trainings.
So. Absolutely a wonderful thing. So I think that's a crucial thing to do. They can get started on skills, doing the assessment of skills, which will get them ahead of the game. And then the other thing, the other component is getting your child healthy. Get the doctor's appointments that you need to take a look at their diet to get it as healthy as possible. You don't have to do anything cold turkey overnight. Julie was talking about that with us, that, you know, you want to be gradual about things, but to get your child as healthy as possible as quickly as you possibly can, all important components.
Right.
But we did have somebody who wrote in and they said, where can a parent go for help for their child when money is drained, regional denied them, and they're a single parent that has nothing left to fight because it's taking everything to survive the day?
Oh, that's terrible. Yeah, and so if the parent is referring to a regional center...
I think so. So that would be
California, right?
Yeah.
So this is... I mean, there's no way that you don't have resources here in California. There's so many resources. So I can completely understand that the parent would be just exhausted from all of it, though. And it's unfortunate. Some of the regional centers do make it harder than others. Yeah. There's no question, and it's difficult to deal with some of them. But now we here we also have insurance coverage, and I mean, I guess what we do for our families is, from the minute you call in, the very first thing is we will get your insurance information while we're even looking to see what we can do or whether we can treat your child. And then our contracts department, Bryce, as you know, will be checking the information on the benefits.
Yes.
That in itself does take a little bit of time because your insurance companies are not always that fast in responding. But once we have their approval, then we start services pretty rapidly. I'm just coming up with a new kind of formula or solution so I can start all the kids on our wait lists. Mm-hmm. I think I've figured it out now how to do that.
Yay!
I know, it'll be really nice because we had a lot of kids join the wait list over the last year, and I feel bad about these little guys waiting. So I think we've figured out how to spread our supervisors differently so that they can take on more kids. But there is funding in California. There's regional center funding, school district funding as well.
Yeah.
And also insurance funding. So I'm not sure how old the child is. I feel horrible that this parent is so worn out.
Here's what I'd like to throw into the mix for this, because we threw out a challenge a couple of weeks ago on the show that I was talking about. We did a sort of funding 101 for autism, and I said what I learned really early on that a really incredible parent said to me is, you're going to find the way. Just get that in your head. You're going to find the way. Mm-hmm. Get the support that you need. But she said there's always a way. I did not believe it. I still can't do the math on it. I don't know how we found the way. I really don't. And I said, but I have that to pay forward. And I said that I would love to take on two families that if you are lost and feel stuck and you need some help and support, that I would love to help you figure it out. Because sometimes you just need another person in there with you.
That's so nice. I'm a bulldog. That's so nice, yeah.
And so if you're interested in working with me on, because Regional Center, you can petition if you've been denied, and I'd be happy to work with you on that and figure out if you what your other resources are, because a lot of times I know what it's like to be overworked, underslept, and feel like there's nothing, you have nobody in your corner. I'd love to be in your corner and to work with you to see if we can't figure out what is there for you.
That's right. And that's so nice of you. Actually, that makes me think, what a wonderful thing that right there, to pay it forward that way, to help another parent. I mean, I wish all parents would do what you just said.
And I think that a lot of parents do in different support groups.
Yes.
But if you don't know how to find the support group to find that parent, it still feels like you're alone. You could be inches from the help, but you just don't know.
It's so true.
So I would say that, and let's work through it together and see if we can't figure it out together, because you're never alone in this. It feels like you are, but you're not.
No, and that's one of the reasons that I love Amy, who does our 800 number.
Yes.
I mean, and she's a clinician. She's been with us for a long time, and she's just so patient and terrific on the phone, and I love, you know, that's why I tell parents, just call our 800 number.
Yes.
Amy will sit on the phone with you for a long time and try to guide you and advise you and tell you where to go. And if she can't, then she'll refer you to Kathy. And there's a lot of people here who will just try to help on the phone as well.
Absolutely. And we should, Emily, give them the 800 number for CARD, because and you will. It's Amy Fuentes that Dr. Granpeesheh is referring to. She was actually one of Jen's senior therapists amazing. She came to us as a fill-in. You know, sometimes your therapist won't be able to come for whatever reason, if they've gotten ill or something has happened, and then a fill-in comes. And that's how we met Amy. Amy would come with her bag of toys.
Yeah, she's great.
And she would be pulling out these new things. She always had something fascinating, different things for Jem to build. A really incredible person. And she takes it's personal with her. So when you call that 800 number, you're not getting, somebody who does not know the deal. Amy wants to get in the trench with you to sort it out.
That's true.
Real, real person who cares deeply. But also, I would like to be on your team. So I can't, unfortunately, I can't do that for absolutely everybody. But I said I could do that for two people. And if more people write in and want to do that, I can find other people who would be willing to do that as well. So don't be by yourself.
Yeah, that's right. Very important.
Okay, we should take a quick break and come back with more of your questions you guys are writing in. It's wonderful. We'll get to as many of them as we can. Don't forget that it's Dr. Granpeesheh's birthday. Mm. And so thrilling that she's here with us today on her birthday. So we'll be right back after these messages. Welcome back to Autism Live for this segment, a special segment of Ask Dr. Doreen. You just saw the time lapse of them shaving my head. We have to say a special thanks to Mark Christopher Lawrence,
absolutely,
the wonderful actor and comic who was here and did such a great job.
He's such a terrific guy.
And he's so giving of his time for autism.
Totally. He really is.
He was with us on Saturday for the Act Today Military Family Run and playing with the kids in the Kids Zone that CARD sponsored.
Yeah.
He was just lovely and delightful. He's going to be back with us, I think, next Wednesday. He is going to co-host Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy, because you and Nancy are going to be in Sacramento, I believe, working on some bills next Wednesday.
Yes.
Some important legislation that you're helping to push through and sponsoring.
Yeah, there's a rally next Wednesday.
My goodness, it is the 17th.
Yeah.
Time flies in the month of April. There's so much going on.
April is very, very busy.
It is a busy, busy month.
Yeah.
But I also have to say, for those of you who, if you want to be writing in to ask Dr. Granpeesheh a question right now, you can on our live feature. This was a question that I promised from last week. It came in right at the end, and I promised we would get to it today. Mm-hmm. Hi, Shannon and Dr. Doreen. Thanks a lot for the segment. My child is 9.5 years old now. When we started sight reading at 4.5 years, he did that very well. However, it took a while for him to read phonetically. Right now, he can read simple words such as number, spoon, etc. on his own, which is great. However, he has started spelling out the words which he learned as sight reading. For example, he says, T-H-I-S, this. I don't know how to tell him that if he knows the word, he need not spell it out. I am confused if I should just ask him to spell silently. Any tips would be great. Also, any ideas on how to build the fluency would be so helpful as well. And they wrote, thank you.
That's so great. I love parents are so amazing. Like, you read these things and you think, how many parents do we know in this world that are just that involved with their kids? It's just amazing to me, these parents. So, you know, I wish there was a real fast answer to that. I guess what you're trying, if you are trying right now just to stop him from, you know, sounding out the letters individually or spelling out the letters, then just when he starts to, you know, ask him, show him a word, and when he starts to do that, just stop him and actually start modeling the full word again. In other words, the minute he starts to say the letters or spell them out, you just stop, and then you'll say the whole word and he'll imitate you. So it's a very, he's just confused. He's just, it's not that he's, you know, he's just trying to figure out now, okay, which one is it? Like, what am I supposed to do? Or when I see a word, do I say the whole thing or do I spell it? Then I say the whole thing. Yeah. He's just confused. So you just need to teach him to, that he should say the words, and he will only really spell them out when you ask him to spell. That's the SD or the discriminative stimulus for that. Having said that, in terms of fluency, I guess, you know, a lot of our kids are sight readers, and that moves things forward pretty fast because they have such an incredible memory. But it is, after all, it becomes limited because you end up, you know, filling your head with thousands of things you've memorized. And in some ways, it is just a starting thing, and it is always better to go to phonetics because then they can spell, sound out pretty much anything. I don't know the child's level of functioning, but in typical development, you are doing everything phonetically probably by about two to three. And so you're starting to recognize sounds and then are able to usually, that's when kids write things phonetically as well, and they start to sound things out in their environment. There's a lot of really good programs out there for just reading. Actually, a lot of good computer programs as well that can teach reading. And so you might want to look in, you know, technology for some options, kids' educational programs. Otherwise, we do have a whole section on this in skills, on how to read words and all that, you know, how to sound out and phonetic reading and all of that. I'm just trying to remember the name of a program that we like, but I've lost it right now. But I mean, if you look up, if you just put in reading programs for kids with autism, a lot of different things come up, so that you can just purchase.
And if you think of it later on today or this week, the then we'll put it on our Facebook so that we'll let people know that that's a good one to do. But awesome that, you know, I love that you're saying, you know, these are two different skills, and awesome that he has them. We're just going to separate them.
Yeah, he's just confused. Yeah,
that's
absolutely
awesome. Because sometimes we get afraid as parents, and that it takes the fear out of it. Okay, bunch of questions here. Just wondering if CARD has any affiliates in Canada or any plans to come here. I think for the most part, each province provides a certain amount of ABA that is covered under our health care. There are still waiting lists, but it is offered. So if you are lucky, you don't have to wait that long. But the more I watch your show and hear about your organization, you seem the best of the best.
That's nice.
Just curious.
Well, my fiance's entire family is Canadian. They're all from Canada. Ah. And so I go to Canada quite a bit. They're from the Toronto area and Cambridge. And so we have done a number of conferences out there. In fact, also in I've done conferences all over Canada, actually, yeah. Come to think of it. Toronto and Vancouver. In October, I'm doing one in British Columbia as well. So you should probably write in if you're interested, because, you know, there's no limitation on us providing this sort of thing anywhere in the world, really. And I'd love to get something started in Canada. Mm-hmm. For me, I decided some years ago that I would really stay focused within the U.S. We did initially, you know, when I started opening card offices many, many years ago, actually, I think I don't remember now the order of the offices, but very early on we opened a clinic in London, mm-hmm. and then later in Oxford in England, and then Australia, mm-hmm. Sydney, and then in Auckland, New Zealand. Mm-hmm. So we did kind of have some international offices going on very early on, and we realized that it takes up a lot of time and effort to deal with the regulations of different countries, and you end up, it just became too difficult where you had, you know, all the employee regulations, human resources type laws, and they're so different from the US. I mean, it's amazing how different they are, you know, like in Australia, for instance, everybody has a paid 6-week vacation at the end of the year, and or like in certain parts.
Let's all move to Australia. Yeah. My goodness, that's exciting.
Yeah, it is. And like the longer you work, the let's say if you work 10 years or something, you get a huge payout when you stop working.
Wow.
There's all kinds of stuff. So I decided to focus more in the States, and then what we started to do was, if there are groups of people who are interested in opening something in their own country, for instance, anywhere in Canada, I'd really love to do that. That would be very easy for us.
Right.
What we would do then is we would basically set up like an affiliate model like we have with our friends in South Africa.
I was just going to say the Star Academy. What a lovely job you
exactly.
guys are doing there.
Yeah. And it's not really just us. It's Ilana and Martin being amazing people. They really, really are amazing people. And sometimes when I go see them, I think some of their staff are just, you know, fabulous. Like, just amazing people, honestly.
Wonderful.
They've developed this program, and all they had when I met them a few years ago was a school, one school.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not even their business. Their business is they're diamond dealers, you know.
So I didn't know that.
They had opened, they had gotten a small building mainly because of their son. And so they had opened the school, and all they wanted to do was just to have a program for him. And I think they had maybe 7 or 8 kids when I went there the first time. And over the course of the following year, basically they changed all their staff. They got people that we liked and we trained. And then what they did is it just became more and more. They grew the training, the quality. And then now they have 4. They have 4 centers, and they're just packed, and they could take on more and more, and the entire country is coming to them for help.
Amazing.
And they are amazing people, and we're still, you know, continuously out there, as you know.
Right.
And John Galley is our director of expansion or remote services is what we call it now. And so what he does is he will go out to the site wherever people are, let's say anywhere in Canada. If you have a school that might be interested in working with us, or psychologists or behavior analysts, we actually have behavior analysts in Canada that we know. So it's just a matter of kind of, you know, getting in touch with us. You'd want to call in or email in and actually talk to John Galley.
Okay. And that's Galle.
Right.
But you can go to the resources tab of CARD and find your way there, or you can send your information and I'll forward it to John personally.
Right. I mean, John's email is j.galle@centerforautism.com, and he'd be happy to hear from you. He's evaluating a lot of different places right now. I mean, he's also involved with our expansion in Hawaii. And he's, of course, very involved with our South America expansion, because he's gone back and forth to Colombia as well. We're trying to do something there. So he's a traveler, and he does a lot. He does, he oversees the South Africa program. Mm-hmm. He did the Middle East for us for a long time. Mm-hmm. And so he'll take it step by step and guide families so that we can try to help set up something. And even if that doesn't happen, obviously we can provide remote services to your child.
Okay.
So you don't have to open a program, you know, in Canada. You can also just have services for your child where a supervisor like John would fly back and forth to you and help your child. We'd hire and train people in the local area and so on.
And it is something that I'm learning as time goes on, and we've said it before on the show, all ABA is not the same.
No, it's not.
And so it's important that you're working with people that are of a caliber. And the only services we ever got were from CARD, and I certainly appreciated it while we were getting it, but over the years, I've come to appreciate how lucky we were.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Shannon. It's hard to keep a high quality of care because there's so many restrictions from every possible way. I mean, it's pretty amazing. Not just things that we're not allowed to do because of our funding sources.
Right.
But then also things that you have to watch for in terms of employee regulations. And it's just really hard to balance all of it. You know, how much training can I actually give my employees? I'm restricted by the amount because, if I give them too much training, then I have to move their level of work level up and continuously. I mean, there's all these different rules. And so, but we try very, very hard. And, you know, like when you hire someone, just for our field, for instance, we fingerprint everyone and get Department of Justice clearances on everyone before they go to anybody's house, before they even have access to a child ever. Yeah. But the problem is, you know, that process takes a while, and they're our employee, and you have to actually get them out there when they're employees. And there's a lot of different restrictions, but we try really, really hard to maintain the quality. I guess the most meaningful thing to me is when I hear parents say exactly like what you just said about Amy Fuentes. Yeah. You know, just the characters of these guys at the junior therapist level or the senior therapist level. And I love to hear that because at every point they're making such a huge difference.
Yeah, well,
and I love that.
I can tell you the people who came into our home changed our lives forever.
Yeah, that's
forever.
Fabulous. That's so great to know.
I'll get all mushy. And for many of those years, I had not had the opportunity to meet you.
That's true.
And they would talk about you, and I would think, thank God for that woman because she created the place that's helping us, but that's who you were to me, the person who created the place. But I was always aware of the fact that we saw such consistency that I was clear on the fact that somebody at the top was doing something really good.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
And then I met you and heard you speak, and literally, I've said before that I got chills and I shook for 2 hours afterwards because you showed us what your plan was. Of how you were going to help children all over the world. And that's when I said, okay, this woman is the real deal. This is an amazing thing. It changed how I looked at autism forever, both first with my child and then later to see what your plan was of how you were going to help as many people as possible.
Yeah, thank you.
You are on an amazing mission in your life. And I'm just happy to be along as somebody who says, what can I do from time to time?
Because I
just think that you're amazing. And that's why I said you're my hero.
Oh, no, I appreciate it, Shannon. But honestly, the truth is, even if you look at all the stuff that we do here, and it's just so many people that are incredible. Like I said, I'm just very, very lucky and blessed to, you know, be in the position to take credit for it, honestly.
Well, but I think it comes from the top.
It does.
Right. You have a staff that's amazing.
They're
incredible
people.
But I think it's because you've attracted them.
Yes, that's true. I mean, people come to CARD now, and I you know, when I talk to the core team, like the higher level senior people that have been here for 20 years, when I talk to them, I always say, don't worry. You know, if someone comes in and they're just not all that good in some way or another, whether as a human being or in behavior analysis, they just don't last that CARD.
They don't,
because the system is pretty tough.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to be good.
Yes.
Otherwise, the other supervisors won't allow you to be there. You know, it's kind of funny. Like, it's a pretty tough group of people, and you are constantly challenged and evaluated and reviewed, and you have to go through so many levels of credentialing and training and pass this exam and that one. And, oh, by the way, you know, all these, what we call the QA drop-ins, quality assurance drop-ins, and they're, you don't know when they're coming, and they just drop in on you. So you have to be good here to survive. But, you know, that core team, the higher level folks who've been here, they're the ones that keep it going. And they're the ones that are amazing.
They are absolutely amazing. We're running out of time. We've got all these questions. Okay. A couple of people who've written in very specifically saying happy birthday to Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh. From our friends at Autism Will Not Define My Son, they wrote in and said, here's to many more happy birthdays. Somebody who wants an example of what he eats for breakfast, packs for lunch, and eats for dinner, which I will get to a little later on. One quick, long question here. Happy birthday, Dr. Doreen. Many best wishes to you and many wonderful years to come. Question for you. My daughter's 6, high-functioning autistic, going through extinction burst, is now hitting her head in walls, chairs, floors, whatever surface is hard and makes a sound. Previously, she used to repeat words nonstop until mom repeats them. I think we talked about this particular person. Now, I'm not repeating them, not even paying attention to the bad behavior and redirecting her to some other activity and prompt her to read it. But she's a smart cookie and now knows that I'm not attending to the bad behavior. So she hits her head and screams, throws herself to the floor, won't let anyone touch her, hits herself, etc. This parent writes that they use skills and language is getting huge, all in capital letters, improvement. Mm-hmm, but behaviors are noted for attention and escape, like on homework time or bathroom time while doing preferred activities. I'm not sure what to do or how to handle this bursting in the right way. Any advice, please, and thanks.
Well, what an amazing parent there again.
Yes.
We don't do enough for these parents. We need to have... Sometimes when I'm on this show, I think we should have just a... I mean, actually, this is one of the legislation things that I'm pushing right now is a telehealth bill.
Yes.
Because I really feel that if we were able to, by law, be allowed to provide really serious guidance through the phone and through, you know, technology like Skype or so on. We'd really be able to help a lot of more people.
Yes.
It's pretty restricted what we can do right now. Every family has to have a certain level of physical contact for us to be able to do telehealth, and it's really important.
Yeah.
Like, in this particular case, the parent wrote two things, and then I went back and forth on this, because the first thing was that the child hits their head and that the parent thinks it's an extinction burst. Mm-hmm. If it is, that means that your child is doing this. See, an extinction burst happens because from the perspective of the child, this is what's going on. The child's thinking, I used to hit my head and everybody would freak out and come and help me or give me attention or allow me to stop doing whatever it was and blah, blah, blah. And so, or I used to do whatever. And now they don't let me do that anymore. So I'm going to freak them out in some other way, or I'm going to do it more so that people do react. And that's what's going on. So it's kind of like the child's thinking, how high do I have to raise the bar here for people to react?
Yeah. So, what's it going to take to get what I used to get easier?
Exactly.
What do I have to bring here?
Exactly.
I'll throw the biggest fit I have to.
That's exactly right. So, you know, it's what you would do in a situation if you want to have the extinction burst shorten, the burst shorten, is you literally leave the room. You don't interact with the child. You don't try to redirect them during an extinction burst ever. You do not redirect them. You literally, the minute an extinction burst starts, you leave. And guaranteed it'll die down much faster. Now, having said that, there's two things I want to caution you about. One is, depending on your child's temper, I guess, or how, you know, dysregulation of their own aggravation. I doubt it. I mean, I've never really seen this, but it is possible that your child might, you know, hit his head or her head hard enough against the wall that it would actually hurt. I don't think that he or she, it's very unlikely that he would do it to a point of physical danger. You'd be amazed that, you know, we think our kids will, but they don't. They're doing it because you're over, you're reacting. That's the main reason that they do it. The one thing, though, that the parent wrote in there which made me rethink it was that the parent wrote something about any surface that makes a sound. And see, that brings in another function for the child. So it's possible that the child's not really doing this only to get your attention, but also because they like the sound. And if that's the case, you know, leaving the room or ignoring the behavior is not going to change it.
Right.
They're going to keep doing it because they like the sound.
And that brings up for me, and I don't mean to interrupt you, but that brings up for me how important it is that you're working with someone when these kinds of things happen.
Definitely.
Because as a parent, you know, we could go back and forth and make a mistake and put the child at risk when we make a mistake. So well, that,
and,
that really brings
and
it
or delay
to
the whole thing. I mean, like, you know, here you are thinking, okay, this is definitely an extinction burst, but is it? I mean, is it really an extinction burst on based on something else you took away, or is the child self-stimulating with the sound of this thing? I don't know. And the way that you would handle that, obviously, is to block it, and then you, that you can replace. If it is a sound effect that the child's getting, then you can allow the child other activities that would produce that sound, which would be
like
fine.
Like a drum or
like
something
drum
else like
or
that.
Or headphones or anything else, right? But if you were certain that the function of this behavior is just that the child wants to get your attention, then that means you remove your attention when that behavior is occurring, and you give your attention when that behavior is not occurring, okay? Yeah. So you leave the room, but the minute that it's not happening, before or after, this would actually be called sort of non-contingent reinforcement, you increase your attention to the child because, and you could even teach the child ways of coming and saying, I need you to play with me, or I need you to be with me, or whatever it is. So essentially, you want to make sure the child's getting attention, but just not for that particular behavior. And again, like Shannon, you said, it's so important to pay attention to the fact that these are not things that you should be doing on your own. Sometimes when we start going into heavy behavioral issues that are, you know, like, I wouldn't even classify this as self-injury, by the way. You know, the classic definition of self-injurious behavior is that it occurred without, not in the presence of anyone. And that's more of a self-stimulatory type thing than than an aggression. So I would say you should try to get in touch with, so I don't know where this parent is.
No, I don't either.
We do have SOS services, which is sort of the specialized outpatient, and we try to help, we will just try to send you a supervisor who can train you and guide you through these types of things.
Absolutely. So crucial when it's things like that. I always like to compare, because, you know, we think with our kids, we should know everything, that as if we they were born and an owner's manual was downloaded in the back of our brain. But if your car weren't functioning and you said it could be the brakes or it could be the electrical system, you would never leave it up to yourself to decide that. You would always go to a mechanic.
Right.
And for, and our kids are certainly more important to us than our cars.
Right. And a lot of times it's also harder for us because we're so subjective about it.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All right. We have to take a short break and we're going to be back after these messages.
Happy birthday, Doreen.
Happy birthday, Doreen.
Happy birthday, Doreen. Happy birthday, Doreen.
Happy birthday, Dr. Doreen. Welcome back to Autism Live.
Great.
We have a very special event today. It is Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh's birthday. And so we have some special guests that are going to be joining us here in the studio to say happy birthday.
Thank you. Oh my gosh.
Because we all love
you
so
you guys. That's
much.
Amazing.
we had the opportunity. So we've got a lot of people here from Autism Live and from our marketing team who are here to wish you the very best birthday.
Thank you.
We are not going to sing. That was our song to you.
That was awesome. Thank you.
But a piece of the cake that was not awesome. Touching my head.
That was the best. I can't believe you guys did that.
Amazing.
We had some very special help from our new production assistant with that as well.
Thank you.
So
that was awesome.
Amazing.
She was. We should let everybody know that we have Dr. Doreen's daughter, Nikki, who has been the biggest help to us. She is now our production assistant, and she has been a whirlwind.
Oh, just
and she was very helpful to that.
Where is she? She didn't come in.
She hid. She hid. But in any case, happy birthday.
Thank you so much.
We love
you
so
much.
Very,
very much.
And we'll
Thank
ask you to make a wish.
I will make a wish. Okay. All right.
Yay.
Thank you, guys. That's
and I
amazing.
Thank you so much for being here.
So awesome.
We will, next week, we're going to be airing a previous episode of Ask Dr. Doreen so that we can let you go ahead, open, so that we can let you go and do legislation in Sacramento because we know that that's very important. So, but then in 2 weeks, we'll be back live with Dr. Doreen here on the show.
Thank you.
We're going to go to a break and show you the A word and give Dr. Doreen a chance to open her present. When we come back, we're going to have Nancy Alspaugh-Jackson joining us for Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. We have the playwright and the two lead performers of a new play called On the Spectrum that has premiered here in Los Angeles. We're very excited to have an opportunity to talk to them. But first, take a look at the A word.
A, B, C, D, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z. Now I know my ABCs. Next time,
won't you?
No, say with me.
That's right, kiddo. Very good.
Hey, Jack Riley, one more minute. Say okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Do you want to play something else for now? What do you want to play?
Pancake.
You want to play pancakes? Oh, is this the sign for pancakes? What do you want to work for, Jack Riley? Do you want to work for puzzle, for trains, for jumping on the bed? What do you want to work for? More jumping?
Pancake.
Okay.
Pancake.
Jessica teaches Jack Riley other social ID questions such as where do you live and what's your last name?
There you go. Nice job. Here you go. Slow down. There you go. Hi.
Aww. You look cute. I love you.
Group kiss. Group kiss. Ready? One, two. Oh, nice hands.
Nice hands get you more attention than bad hands.
Big brother. Who's big brother?
Who's a big brother?
Yes. Where's the little sister?
Where's the little sister?
Is she here?
That's right.
Can she have a kiss? Can little sister have a kiss? Thank you.
We'll hope.
Jack Riley is needing less prompting to appropriately gain attention. Jessica only gestures to get him to ask. They introduced the skill about 7 weeks ago, and it's becoming less contrived and is occurring naturally in situations. Here's a look from 7 weeks ago, when Jessica first introduced gaining attention. In the beginning, she tempts Jack Riley with an item he wants, then prompts him the whole way, gesturing and physically showing him what to do and what to say. As time goes by and the skill becomes more natural, the prompting will completely fade away.
Ready? Okay, show them how you can use a straw. You gotta go all the way. Show me. There you go.
Good job. Yay.
Feeding used to be very time consuming and difficult for Cheryl and Mike. Jack Riley would swat away food fed to him and would refuse to self-feed. He now feeds himself and even uses a fork. His diet, though, is still limited, but it's growing. Drinking has also been an issue for Jack Riley. He's typically only drank out of baby bottles or bottles with a hard nipple top. They've tried getting Jack Riley to drink from a cup, but every time they would present it, he would try to lap it up like a cat, anticipating all the fluid to come rushing at him. Now they have introduced drinking from a straw, so he has an item to drink from that is age appropriate.
Suck it up.
Yay!
Yay!
You did it!
You did it!
You want to do that again?
Yeah.
Want to do that again?
One more time, and then you can play.
Yay!
Very good, Jack.
You guys got that exact same pitch level there.
Yeah.
I don't know how you duplicate.
Do you want the purple iPhone?
Papa.
Okay.
Okay.
You can have it. You can have it. You can have it. You can have it. Come here. Can you show me? Bite for mommy.
Mm. Your turn.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Do you know?
So Ryan,
say, I don't want banana.
A banana.
Okay. Do you? What do you want then? What do you want then? I want.
I want some.
Okay.
One of the food items Jack Riley eats a lot of are bananas. For some reason, though, seeing a banana really upsets Jack Riley. He enjoys eating it, but hates the sight of it. One of the issues is that biting solid food is very aversive to him.
Fear of the banana. Someday we'll tell him he eats one every day.
More awareness than it was in the yogurt, so we have to go baby steps with it. That's fine with me.
Drink the whole thing.
With like no prompting, no.
Yeah, you're right.
Okay, kiddos. See ya. Have a good weekend.
Say thanks, Miss Jessica.
You say bye. Can you say bye, Jessica?
Look at her.
Bye, Tasha.
Where is Jessica? There she
Thank
is.
Thank you. Oh, thanks. Just in case you were wondering.
You're Jessica. You are.
Bye, guys.
Bye. Have a great weekend, Jessica.
Good morning, and welcome to Two Chicks Talking About Autism, better known as Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy. I'm sitting here with my bravely, boldly bald friend, Shannon Penrod.
And I'm sitting here with my gorgeous, beautiful friend who's rocking a new haircut.
New haircut,
Nancy,
I thought,
Alspaugh-
yeah, I'm
going
to cut off some of my locks to be a little closer to you, but you've got a lot more chutzpah
but
than I do.
But I am loving this. This
Thank
is a great
you.
New haircut. You
Thank
look absolutely. This color is good for you. You
Thank
look,
you.
But you well, always look fabulous.
Well, you know what? I think this new hairstyle on you brings out your eyes.
Well, that and all the makeup I've been piling on. But now I'm seeing that I need a little work maybe underneath.
I don't think so.
I wouldn't be one of those people who could do it anyway. Yeah. I'd talk a good game, but
well,
I wouldn't do it.
Well, as everybody knows, Shannon shaved her head for a Compassion in Action, her personal example of Compassion in Action, which this month here at Autism Live, we are urging everybody to do their own act of compassion. compassion, and we're celebrating Autism Awareness Month. And yes, it doesn't necessarily have to be autism related.
No, it could be. I mean, we're, the message that we're sending is that this community is a very compassionate community.
Yes.
So you can do something for somebody on the spectrum, absolutely, or for a family that is working through autism. Mm-hmm. But you can, any act of compassion is a valid act of compassion and counts towards autism awareness.
That's right.
We're teaching people who we are and how we like to be treated.
Okay.
That's
very good.
What we're doing.
That's great. So if think of your own act of compassion. It can be towards someone with autism. It can be if you are someone on the spectrum. We're teaching the rest of the world how
to
be compassionate.
Right. We're modeling the behavior.
We're modeling the behavior.
The thing that we always talk about.
Yes. Is. And tell me how people have reacted since Monday.
It's been a really interesting thing. I mean, the people who watch the show, I've gotten all these emails from people saying, okay, now I want to do something. I want to do something. And then some people have written and told us what they are going to do, and we're going to start covering that. And we've asked people to send in videotape of what they're going to do.
Okay.
It's been interesting for people who don't know why I shave my head. I get some looks. I'll be walking by people, and I forget.
Right.
And so people will be looking at me, and I think, what's going on? What's happening? Oh, right. And then I smile at them. It really has been a conversation starter. And it was a very interesting thing with my own child, as you all know, who's on the spectrum. He thought it was great that I did it, but then once mom was home with no hair, he decided he did not care for it, and then I needed to go buy a wig immediately. A hat was not enough.
Okay.
And the expression that he used, he said, "You're embarrassing me."
Oh, okay.
And I said, "This is the new word." And I said, "Is that really the word that you want to use?" And we talked again about what embarrassing was. Mm-hmm. I said, "Or does it just make your tummy feel funny?" He said, "My tummy feels funny. You don't look like my mom."
Okay.
And I said, "Well, you know, that's a valid thing, but let's see what it feels like in a couple of days." Now, yesterday I went to his school and I was wearing a beanie because my head was cold. He ran up and said, "Mom, you have to show them," and took it off and said, "Look, everybody, look what my mom did." So I don't think embarrassment was any part of it.
Okay. Well, I brought you my favorite cap that I think is just beautiful. It actually matches my jacket. And
it
I brought
does.
You this to wear when you go out at night with your husband.
Oh, it's absolutely
And it, you wear
gorgeous.
It kind of on the side. We'll try it on before the end of the show.
Okay, all right.
Okay, because I think, you know, if you're going out somewhere special and you want to look a little dressed up, I think it'll be beautiful
it's
on you.
It's absolutely beautiful.
And then it's by some designer, Eugenie Kim, who does a lot of, I guess she's very hip with the Hollywood stars that wear this kind of bohemian look.
Oh, it's
But I thought
lovely.
It would be very pretty on you. So we're going to put that.
Beautiful.
We're going to put that on you before the end of the show.
Okay, fabulous.
Okay?
And we have a very exciting show
today. I'm so excited about this. Got a call from a friend of mine who happens to be a playwright and a writer, Brad Schreiber, and he said, "Have you heard about this new show called On the Spectrum at the Fountain Theater in Hollywood, California?" And I had actually just read the review in the LA Times, and it got a really great review.
Yes.
It's gotten a lot of buzz, and we have Ken Lazebnik. Who is the playwright. We're going to talk to him first, and then we have the two leads, Dan and Virginia, who play the two young people on the spectrum. It's a love story, not your neurotypical love story.
I love it, and we're very excited to have them here with us in the studio. I want to remind everybody, if you have questions as we're talking to them, you can use the live feature at www.autism-live.com and send your questions in for these amazing people working on this beautiful piece of theater. We're very excited.
So we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we'll be back with Ken Lazebnik, the playwright, and find out what inspired him to write On the Spectrum.
Wonderful.
Stay with us.
You say hi, and we say hi. Let's get wild, let's get wild. Let's get, let's get, 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 let's get wild.
Hi, welcome back to Autism Live. I'm Lisa Ackerman. We're here doing allergy-free cooking, and I brought my sister with me today.
Jamie Davis. Thanks for having me.
A lot of people are asking about a allergy-free breakfast, and breakfast can be full of crap.
But it's full of crap, and it's hard to do. We don't have time in the morning. We're in a hurry.
We're going completely nut-free. The recipe is not...
Personality, we can't do anything about.
Yeah, can't do anything about that. So we're going to start off first with... I'm using sorghum and brown rice flour. I find the texture good, and I've added some flaxseed meal. We talked about that last time, flaxseed meal for poop. Almost every one of our kids has a poop issue. What's next on the recipe is the quinoa flakes, baking powder, cinnamon, and the xanthan gum. It brings the glutinous texture back into the flour. And often what happens with these recipes is they can fall apart. This one holds up nicely. I like it. For the folks that are egg-free, we have a ton of egg replacers. One of those can be the arrowroot starch or bringing back some additional flaxseed. So there's a lot of options to go eggless, but we're going to go egg-full in this one. For sweetener, I use the maple syrup. I stay away from refined sugar. What I'm adding now is the coconut milk, maple syrup, and a little bit of the coconut oil. And we're going to add in the raisins, craisins, and chocolate chips at the end. You'll find that chocolate chips can coax people to eat some really amazing things. When we started, Jeff had 42 food allergies, so we had to get creative in how we cooked. So nuts were a big, big issue. What I like now is that he can tolerate so many more things after start doing this diet. So let me show you how you can deal with this sticky stuff here. You get your fingers really wet, and you can push it down. So my oven has been preheated. It's at 350 degrees. So we're going to just throw this in. Like I said, I like it around 23 minutes. And the magic oven says, I'm done. Looks like. Don't you love magic ovens? They're awesome. Here we go. Pops right out. The texture of these, and it's so pretty. It looks almost like a big chocolate chip cookie, but you actually made it healthy. But you can be my guinea pig. Tell me what you think.
It looks really good.
Doesn't it? So the textures and the colors in there are just beautiful. So the raisins are for you, the chocolate chips are for your kid.
I can't believe it's gluten-free.
I know, right? It doesn't taste like, you know,
crap.
We're wrapping up another cooking show. If you have feedback, you can email us at autismlive@gmail.com. We're, of course, on Facebook. You could go to facebook.com/autismlive. And of course, Taco Now has thousands of recipes. Join me there, and we can cook some more later on. So thanks for joining us. You say hi, and we say hi. Let's get wild, let's get wild, let's get wild.
Skills is an online program that provides assessment, curriculum, positive behavior support planning for challenging behavior, and progress tracking, and it does this all in one place. The skills assessment and curriculum addresses 8 areas of development, which even includes advanced higher level areas such as executive functions and cognition, which pretty much makes skills the only ABA-based set of curricula for teaching more complex skills, things like problem solving, planning, self-management, perspective taking, and even inferring and predicting others' private events. Skills is a 4-step system. Step 1 is to add the child to your account. Step 2 is to start assessment. The skills assessment is the only ABA-based assessment with psychometric research demonstrating the language subscale to have excellent reliability. Every area of human functioning and typical child development from infancy to adolescence was researched, making the skills assessment the most comprehensive of its kind in the world, and we're quite proud of that.
Skills is easy to use. Simply click Start Assessment and begin answering questions. Or simply type in a keyword, find specific activities to assess, and add activities to treatment. Step 3. Choose activities. Once you've completed the assessment, Skills selects from a pool of 4,000 activities categorized by age, level, and skill type to provide you with exactly those activities each child needs. Start by choosing a curriculum, then a lesson, and finally an activity. Click the information icon to view prerequisites, ages in which targets develop, examples, and IEP goals. Click the video icon to watch a short video. Once you've identified an activity you want to teach, adding activities to treatment is a snap. Step 4, start treatment. Here you can access customizable activity lesson details, add your own customized targets and exemplars, and edit an activity status such as introducing or mastering it. You can even print handouts such as worksheets, tracking forms, visual aids, and other materials. Skills also offers multiple progress charts mapping curriculum progress, lesson progress, and cumulative number of activities and targets mastered over time. The Skills language curriculum is categorized by verbal behavior type so that users can identify progress for verbal operants, such as echoics, mans, tacks, and interverbals.
Skills Skills is one of the only programs that provides the ability to write behavior intervention plans, or BIPs, for challenging behavior.
With just a few clicks, the outline of the behavior intervention plan is written for you and ready to be printed and implemented.
You can learn more about Skills today and get started by visiting us at www.skillsforautism.com, or you can call us at 877-975-4559. Skills. Progress starts here.
We are back with Let's Talk Autism, and we have a very special guest, Ken Lazebnik.
Excellent.
We said it right.
Yes.
Okay.
Great to be here.
Great to have you here, and you are the playwright of this great new production that is just got such a buzz all over Los Angeles called On the Spectrum. Mm-hmm. And we want to find out, Ken, first of all, what inspired you to write this?
Yeah. Well, it's very personal to me. I have two nephews and a niece who are on the spectrum, and I've been very engaged with their lives over the last 20 years.
Okay.
And
How old are they?
Well, now the eldest is 22, and then there's a 17-year-old, and then a 13-year-old in Israel, actually, the niece. But over the years, this has been a subject that obviously I've been very personally engaged with. By the way, I have to insert here, love your show.
Oh, thank you.
I was watching as a waiting. Great, great show. Wonderful service you provide.
Thank you. So, we love doing it.
And it looks great. It's a great looking show.
Well, thank you. You know,
well, we appreciate that.
Yeah, we like you coming here. Especially somebody with your background.
Yes,
my gosh,
absolutely.
Your resume is quite impressive.
It is.
Well, in terms of the interest in writing about these characters,
yes.
My initial play about that sort of investigated autism was commissioned by the Mixed Blood Theater in Minnesota, which is a strange name for a theater, but it's a pioneer in multiracial casting and colorblind casting, and has, over the last 10 years, done a lot of plays that investigate issues about disability.
Okay.
And so that play, Vestibular Sense, they all have sort of these...
I was saying before we started, I love the titles of your plays. They're absolutely wonderful. So you have Vestibular Sense.
That was your first one.
That's my first one. Then I wrote a play a few years later for Cincinnati Playhouse in the Park to tour to young audiences.
Okay.
And this was called Theory of Mind, which was a smaller...
Another great name.
A smaller, shorter piece, really about a young man in Los Angeles trying to take a young woman out on a date, and things go wrong. He's on the spectrum, she's not, and there's misunderstandings. And then the Mixed Blood Theater was producing that play, and the director of that theater, Jack Ruler, was getting a lot of engagement with the online community, which, as you know, it's growing, burgeoning. And especially, he started engaging with some people who were sort of online activists investigating the interesting question of, you know, is autism a disability or a difference? And he thought that question was interesting, and he said, would you like to write a third play that sort of deals with that? And so I was thrilled to be asked and thrilled to write it. It is a love story.
Yes.
It's a love story between two people on the spectrum.
Okay.
And I thought that it's as I say, I tried to make it as close to my own experience as I could. It's very much about a young man who's very high-functioning.
Asperger's,
who has worked his whole life with his mother.
His mother is the autism warrior mom,
yes,
who has done every intervention,
absolutely,
every behavior therapy, every devoted her life.
And from my understanding, her goal is that he is going to be included, and that in a large sense, people can meet him, and on first meeting, they have no idea.
He can pass the bar of neurotypical,
that
magical thing.
Yes. Under certain circumstances, not so much.
Exactly.
But most of the time, and I like the term that you use, that passing.
Right.
And to the mom, that's really, really important.
Right, exactly. And he's about to apply to law school, and she's very nervous about this. And they hit a financial crisis. And he goes online to look for a job and ends up, through his online search, meeting a young woman. And their initial engagement is strictly online. What the audience sees initially that he doesn't is that she is very heavily affected. And that her communication
nonverbal.
Nonverbal. She uses... In a variety of know, things. She uses augmentative communication device, you know, proliquo.
And so technically non-vocal.
Yes.
But she has some words.
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
no, and she does by, and then once they meet, she does, as she says, I do a lot of things. I play with a lot of things. Mm-hmm. And she does speak. It's just... Mm-hmm. It's, what should I say, forced speech. It's, you know, it's not comfortable.
And she has a lot of what we know in the autism community as STEMs, or self-stimulatory behaviors.
Right, exactly. Okay. And so really, I don't want to give too much away.
Okay, we don't want to give it away because we want everybody watching that can go see it to go see it. I'm going to come. I've not seen the play. I'm going next Thursday. We're having a talk back after the performance with actually Jacqueline Schultz, the director.
And can I just insert here? Yes. The Fountain Theater is one of the great treasures of L.A. Jacqueline, who's a fantastic director, has just directed this production beautifully. She's been very engaged. In over 10 years, I think she's directed, I don't know how many shows for the Help Group.
Yes.
So she is, this is her world. Mm-hmm. You know, Stephen Sachs, who's the one of the two artistic directors of the theater, they're married, and Stephen's, you know, a great person, too. So I can't speak highly enough of just this wonderful production and the fantastic cast that you'll get a chance to meet. Yeah.
They are going to be with us, the two romantic leads.
Yes.
Now, casting them, let's talk about that for a minute.
Yeah.
That must have been a pretty daunting challenge, because you want to cast two people that are, you don't want to get criticism from the autism community that these are not realistic portrayals.
Right.
How did you go about casting it?
Well, it was a difficult process, and we were very, very sensitive to that. I should maybe go back a step to say that in Minnesota, the director there, Jack Ruler, was very committed to the idea of casting people who were on the spectrum.
Right.
And in fact, you did have the girl played by someone who
Laura
was on
Robinson,
the spectrum.
Laura Robinson, who was fantastic. Laura, who's not an actress, but it comes from my hometown, Columbia, Missouri. Mm-hmm. Yay, Columbia. And and she, I had just shared the script with her, and she said, you know, I really love this. I said, I knew Jack was trying to find someone on the spectrum to play the role. He was having difficulty in Minnesota, and I said, you know, would you be interested in reading? And she did, and he cast her. Mm-hmm. And it was a remarkable performance, as in, you know, Virginia's performance is equally stunning. Mm-hmm. So it was just a different philosophy. That was the Minnesota kind of philosophy.
Sure.
But here in Los Angeles, you know, Jacqueline, Stephen, who are just consummate people of the theater, went through a very extensive search, and I'm thrilled with the cast we have. They are deeply committed to authenticity.
Yeah.
They'll tell you their own stories about how they investigated
and researched. Right.
But they are wonderful. And Jeannie Hackett, who plays the mother, is a spectacular actress. So I just couldn't be happier with the cast here. But it was hard, because exactly, you want to make sure that there is a level of authenticity, because the last thing you want to do is have I was hearing you speak about compassion earlier.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, what's been wonderful about both productions is that people on the spectrum, parents of kids, therapists have come and totally embraced the production. And we can always tell when there's either a parent or a therapist in the audience, because there's certain laugh lines.
Those little buzzwords.
Get it. Interesting. And I, you know, we talked a little bit about the play, and we don't want to give too much away, but I do want to go back and say that it seems the central question here is something that comes up a lot in our community, this idea of, you know, we have on the one hand the mom who is concerned about having the young man overcome and fit in with society, but then there's another point of view of, maybe you should just accept me for who I am and the fact that
I'm
different.
The young woman in the
play. That's her point of view.
Her point of view is that, you know, the world needs to adjust to us more than we need to adjust to the world. And this is something we encounter quite often in our community. And it's a fine line we walk, because we don't want it to appear that when we say, you know, there is a chance for recovery when children are very young and can get the proper interventions, that there is something bad about having autism.
Right.
It is a fine line. We want to respect the differences, and we certainly know there are many, many high-functioning individuals out there who are very happy with who they are, we were talking about Alex Plank, who we had on the show on Monday, who runs Wrong Planet. Mm-hmm. He, as he said, I'm still autistic. If I take the test, I test as autistic. Mm-hmm. And I said, and Shannon agreed, if my son grows up to be like you, Alex, I will be very happy, no matter where he falls on what spectrum. Yeah.
And as a playwright, I thought that's what's fascinating, because it is a real conflict, a conflict both of attitude and aspirations and desires. And I try hard not to, you know, be, to preach either side, but to try to let each side have its day in court and let that conflict play out. And I thought the fact that these two people are in love, to me, hopefully sends this message of there's a middle ground, or there's a
way we can transcend.
You can transcend.
Love transcends everything, really. Yeah. I mean, it sounds maybe cliched, but it's true. Yeah.
And we actually have a clip, and we should warn folks at home that it has some adult themes in it. Mm-hmm. There's nothing inappropriate, but there are some adult themes. So if you have the little ones watching, you might be aware of that. But some of the things we've just talked about are hit upon in these series of clips. So we'll take a look and see. These are some scenes from On the Spectrum.
You escape the tyranny of the masses.
Can the badger speak with an English accent?
I don't know. We could use Graham. He's one of the British voices in Proloquo.
Like a computer-generated voice.
It's the one I use.
And Matt, I think she's scamming you.
No!
I don't know what else to call it. She's got you working for free.
She's going to pay.
When?
She said she'd pay!
I don't believe her.
She will! Ow! Don't scam it! She will! 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 She will!
Do we have sex now?
I think we're supposed to make out some more first.
And then we have sex.
I don't have a condom.
Well, that's a problem.
I didn't know that this was going to happen.
Me neither.
If I knew that this was a possibility, I would have stopped at a CVS to buy a condom. Although, I'm not sure what kind to buy. It's like laundry detergent. There's so many options. But the world owes you nothing. The world does not owe you, Iris. You cannot expect the world to reach out to you.
If there were a pill that would take away his autism, you would give it to him. Wouldn't you?
I'm filled now. Yes, dear reader. Filled now with love.
There's the website where you can go to get tickets, but you're selling out, I understand.
We're doing really well. I'm very, very happy with it. But there are tickets available.
People can go to Fountain Theater, all one word together, .com, theater spelled T-H-E-A-T-R-E. And the number is 323-663-1525. I cannot wait to see the play on Thursday.
And you're seeing the play, and then there is a talk back afterwards.
There's a talk back afterwards with some a specialist from the help group and maybe a few other guests. And we'll be talking about, I think, probably our experience with autism in society, in the real world, and how it pertains to the play. And I'm sure, for me, it's going to be very interesting, because with an 11-year-old who I see is starting to get into that tween age you know, asking me, like, he comes up and he'll kiss me on the lips, and I'm trying to explain to him, you know, that's not how we kiss mommy, you know, anymore. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep. We'll give mom a kiss here. And, you know, these issues of love, sexuality, it's a tough time for parents with children with autism.
It's what's fascinating to me always is that their children move through developmental phases mm-hmm. and to try to parse out what is a normal developmental strangeness or growth or weirdness, and then what is part of a diagnosis.
Yes.
It's like so heavily interwoven together. It's really challenging.
Very. Yeah. And you, I'm sure, experienced that with your niece and nephews.
Yeah. And the and in fact, when my nephew was a teenager mm-hmm. and exploring, all right, I'd really love to have a girlfriend, this is going to be tough, that prompted the script that of Theory of Mind.
Yeah, there's also a wonderful movie that just came out called The Story of Luke.
Yes.
And we had Alonzo Mayer on the show.
Mayer,
you might want to look that up.
Yeah.
And then we had Lou Taylor Pucci.
Yes.
The young actor is remarkable.
Wow.
So check that out. I know it's...
You can get it on Amazon right now.
Okay. The Story of Luke.
Yes.
Okay. You'll want to check
that
out.
It's amazing. Yeah. Amazing film.
Yeah. So what are your aspirations for the play, Ken?
Well, I would love for it to continue to reach a wider audience. You know, I mean, I love this production, and, you know, I could wave a magic wand and move this production to regional theaters around America. I still feel as though there's one more piece of work I'd love to do, and you know how it is with theaters. You always want to do one more fix.
Yeah.
So I would love to get one more shot at a little revision.
Uh-huh.
What I found is that it connects with people in the community in this very profound way, and that when we were in Minnesota, we got this call from somebody in St. Louis saying, "Can you bring this to St. Louis?"
Mm-hmm.
And "Can you bring this to Atlanta?" And I will say, because of the beautiful, beautiful, gorgeous technical work, you'll see there's computer animation mm-hmm. that's quite spectacular. It's not quite so easy to travel. It's not designed really as like a pick it up and travel with a show. It's more you have to have a production.
Well, then again, neither was Cirque du Soleil.
Well, there you go.
Yeah.
Right.
So can they if anybody is interested around the country, that should they contact you at the Fountain Theater?
Please. Please do.
All right. If you're watching today and you'd like to bring this production to your city. Ken is open.
And we found out during the break that you're practically autism royalty, that your sister also has written some books on autism, one that I happen to own, one of the first books I read on autism, so it's Small World.
Yeah, Sister-in-law.
Excuse me.
Claire Scoble-Lezebnik has written two wonderful books about the experience of parenting on the spectrum. Mm-hmm. She wrote them in collaboration with Dr. Lynn Cagle, who runs the UCSB Autism Clinic.
Very familiar with Dr. Cagle. Yes.
And she's wonderful. The books are great.
Well, we're gonna get her on the show.
Great.
We're gonna get her number from you after this.
And also, I can't leave without saying, but you also are somebody who is a frequent writer on the Prairie Home Companion, and also co-wrote the movie by the same title. And I'm a huge fan.
Quickly say that Garrison Keillor is the real thing. He is the most prolific genius I've ever met. So I always say it, especially if folks in the business, that it's not as though he has like writers hidden away or something.
Oh, really?
I always said, when I was working on the radio show, I wrote the 5 minutes of the 2 hours that he didn't. And that's literally true. I mean, he is unbelievably prolific.
Well, thanks for not bursting our bubble today.
Yeah.
All right, now we have the two leads in this. And so we could talk to you all an hour.
No, you want to talk to Virginia and Dan.
We want to get Virginia and Dan out here.
Absolutely.
So we're going to say goodbye to you, and I will see you Thursday, and we will, everybody, please go see this play.
Awesome.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, we'll be right back with Dan or Virginia, either one.
Okay.
All right.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. It's April, which means it's also spring. And what we're going to be doing today is making our very own Chia Pets. What's cool about this project, it's an activity that you can revisit with your family as you watch it grow and change. All right, now that I piqued your interest, let's get to it. The materials we'll be needing are water, dirt, arts and craft materials, chia seeds, a container, and nylon. So let's get started. It's super easy. All you're gonna do is you're gonna take an old pair of nylons that you have, you're gonna cut off the toe, and what you're gonna do is you're gonna take some of your chia seeds and sprinkle them at the very bottom. We don't need too much, just a little bit. And then once I've got my chia seeds there, I'm gonna take my dirt and pour that in. And we wanna make sure that we've got quite a bit in there. You want to keep this tail. What this does is acts as a way to soak up the water to feed your little chia plant. So I'm going to take the bottom now. I'm going to tie this into a knot. So now that I've got this little guy, now it's time to decorate him. And you can decorate him however you feel like. What I did is that I made some little features out of felt that I'm going to add to my little guy to give him a face. Now that I've got them all decorated, I'm going to pour some water into my container and make sure my tail is all nice and soaked up in there. And here's my little buddy. I made a mouse, but you can always make whatever kind of creature your child finds super reinforcing. Make sure they like the little animal that you make so they'll want to come back and revisit him. As you can see right now, he's a little bald, but hopefully, keeping your fingers crossed, in a week he'll have some hair. With the snap of my fingers, we're going to go through a week in a few seconds. And
oh my gosh, this little guy has changed quite a bit. Can you see how? Yeah, he's got some hair now. You can have your kids describe how this little guy looks to their friends. And you can even work on body parts by having them label all the features that this little guy has on his face. So let's see, what does he have? He's got eyes, a nose, a mouth, and ears. What do you think will happen to him if I stop watering him? Yeah, he probably won't be growing any more hair if I did that. Well, I hope you enjoyed this activity. I know I did. Tune in next time, okay? And until then, craft on. Bye, guys.
Can you see me? Can you see me flying by your side?
Just that idea
let's talk autism with Shannon and Nancy. Yeah. We're having such an interesting time meeting this young actor, and it's Dan Shaked.
Yes, Shaked. Yes, you can call me Shake Not Stirred. People say that sometimes, but it's Shaked.
Now, Dan, first of all, you know, this must have been a real daunting challenge taking this on.
Yeah.
Because I can imagine there must be a fear being judged by those on the spectrum, mm-hmm. because you're not on the spectrum.
Right, right.
Tell us about taking this role.
Well, you know, I, over time, spent so much time with so many different kids on the spectrum, on different levels of it, that I didn't feel at some point like I had to make one strong decision about what it means to look autistic or what it means to feel autistic, mm-hmm. and I can combine my own fears and my own obsessions. And one of the best things that someone told me was a mother of an autistic kid is that when you meet one autistic kid, it's you meet one autistic kid. And I went, well, then when you meet me, you've met me. So I don't really need to do anything to come off as a stereotype of autism or look a certain way. But there's general mannerisms, and I worked a lot sensorily with it, about feeling, smell, touch, because as trained at Strasbourg, which is very much about into sensorial work, autistic kids are very heightened, I've learned, about sense.
Yes.
The colors, the lights. So I use that as my base, I think, to get to the core of the character, to the truth of it, and let everything else kind of fall into place around it.
Right.
And so this character that you're playing, he's how old?
He's 23.
23, getting ready. He's applying to law school, mm-hmm. and has this mom who, she sounds a little familiar to me.
Yeah, kind of like us. The autism warrior mom does every intervention, every treatment, mm-hmm. everything to bring her child to be the highest functioning he can be. And she gets there.
And I think, and what I think that's also important is the kid appreciates it in the play. Mm-hmm. This isn't a relationship between a mother and son that there's this anger and mm-hmm. frustration. There is a little bit, but the kid wants to help the mom.
Right.
He sees that the mom has lost money, and he goes, I'm going to use my skill in autism, which is sustained concentration, mm-hmm. and I'm going to apply it, and I'm going to make it an advantage rather than a disadvantage. Mm-hmm. And I think his mom sees that over time, and that strengthens our relationship over time.
And then through this, wanting to use your strength and get employment and bring money in, you meet this young woman. First, you meet her virtually.
Mm-hmm.
And technology, as we heard, plays a big part of the play, that, you know, your conversations with her and online, that you guys have a technical way of showing, demonstrating all that. But then eventually, it turns into a potential love interest. Now,
right.
this, this is an arena that, you know, I just talking about when my son gets it, and, you know, my butt cheeks get tight.
Well,
I'm sure you know what I mean.
Well, yeah, but I do kind of live for the day that I see Wyatt make out. I'm sorry.
Really?
Yeah.
Terrifying.
It's just, well, no, because it's a desire I have for him to have that
kind
of.
Of course, I have a desire, but I don't want to see it, Nancy.
Well,
It does it, and I can see. And when I see my mom see me interacting with her in a romantic or sexual way, it's very loving, and it's really, I think it's something that all moms want their kids to see, whether they're autistic or not. And the way we express it is not that different. I've learned it's just it's actually more interesting and engaging actually than to watch sometimes not neurotypical people be in love because they're actually connected. You can see their connection.
These cues and possibilities, and we just saw the clip, and there was a moment when the two of you kiss, and she says, "Okay, can we have sex now?"
Right.
Is this the next step, having sex now? You know, so there are some difficulties that come with and catching those cues. And it's interesting that in the research that I read, the mom is maybe a little bit concerned because her vision of what this young man was going to do and who he was going to be in a relationship with, she hadn't factored in that maybe it would be someone who was on the spectrum, and more profoundly affected than the child.
Right.
She just worked so hard
to
make look
like
fall
in love with a typical person. Right.
And I think maybe that comes from maybe not understanding what makes me as the autistic kid, what makes me happy is going to be different than what makes her happy. And other moms have told me that too, that part of the struggle is to kind of go, okay, that's what my son likes. My son likes Greek gods, and he likes to talk about other worlds and fantasy things, and being okay with that and loving that he loves that and going, that's his thing, not mine, and I'm happy that he loves that.
Right. And it's that constant challenge between wanting them to fit in the neurotypical, because let's face it, we live in a neurotypical world.
Right.
And then to respect the differences as well, which is really what the heart, I think, of the play sounds like it's about.
So you've had an opportunity to have audiences come and see this, and you've gotten some great reviews. What kinds of things are the parents of kids, or have you had some individuals who are older and on the spectrum who've come to see it and had an opportunity to talk to
I've had a couple of mostly men with Asperger's because I've heard that it's more something like 70% Asperger's in men and 30.
Yeah.
And a lot of psychoanalysts said that the behavior was very convincing, and that's what I was worried about the most is the behavior, because this kid is trying to come off is neurotypical. It's had 20 years of work, but he's still autistic, and you can't escape that.
Right.
So to find that balance of when he would show a little more of his autism and when it would be pulled back and kind of learned more and trained from all the OT work that he's done, and finding those times when I'm calm and when I have outbursts has been really the thing to look for. And all the people that have come, most of them have said, you really found that balance between that push and pull.
Well, there's no higher compliment than that.
Kathy Baker came the other night, and she said, you know, I wasn't sure if you, when I bowed, she said, I wasn't sure if they hired an autistic kid.
And I said,
that's the best compliment from a great actress and from someone who I think, you know, is friends with Ken Lezebnik and his brother, and said they're very aware of it. And that's a great compliment to hear that I can find that.
Absolutely.
So, yeah.
It is a great compliment.
It was great.
Well, we are so excited for the success and for all of the great reviews you're getting. And I'm very excited to see it on Thursday.
Thank you very much.
Of next week. And we are about to meet your other half in the play.
Virginia was amazing.
Virginia. Yes. So we'll hear about her character, and we wish you the best.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining
us. Thanks for having me. Thanks a lot.
We'll be back with more of On the Spectrum.
When you find out you're having a boy, you always think, like, oh, he's going to play football, he's going to do this and that. And then when he's diagnosed, all those things get washed away.
It's like that piece that's always in the back of your mind, you know? Where is he? What is he doing? Is he safe?
We really didn't know what we were dealing with. I wish that they could have directed me a little bit more and provided me some information.
I was a young mom. I didn't know what it was like to raise a boy, despite a boy with autism.
Hundreds of thousands of families are not getting the help they need for their children with autism all around the country. ACT Today is determined to bridge the gap. these families really have to go through a lot to get a grant. The application process isn't easy. The records, the diagnosis proof, they're really battling for their kids. So when we can give them a grant, it is so wonderful to see that they succeed in getting that help for their children. Our founder, Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh, is an amazing woman, and she is one of the world's foremost authority on behavior of children with autism. She's extremely knowledgeable, and she oversees every single grant we give. She is part of that process. People may think of autism care and treatment as simply schooling or therapy, but you know, we provide important safety supports, things like fencing, for example. The whole family's living in fear of that child running out into traffic. I recently delivered an iPad to a little boy with some of the apps that are out there for children with autism. Miracles happen.
I got the iPad from ACT.
From ACT?
What did it say? Can you repeat that, Dustin?
I got the iPad from ACT.
We have helped so many military families. And when I think of these brave families that are fighting two battles, one to protect our country and one for the right treatment and care for their children, it breaks my heart. And I think we have to do more as a nation to help them.
There's not a day that doesn't go by that we don't think about it. Some people say, oh, he's normal. You don't see the battles that I see every single day. My husband does have to deploy, and when they get on that bus, that might be the last time that my kids ever see them.
So I called, and they informed me that he had received the grant, which was like a blessing from above. I was just like speechless. I just started to cry because, you know, without it, we would have been lost.
The ACT grant was a total miracle. Without that, we wouldn't be able to receive a service dog. So we're so appreciative what they've done for us as a family.
Recently, ACT Today funded a program for military children with autism in San Diego, the Inclusion Films Program, which is run by Joey Travolta, and teaches kids on the autism spectrum literal filmmaking skills. They learn how to make a movie.
Are we ready? There you go, got it. Okay.
Everything that goes into the process of making a film goes into everyday life. So they're learning life skills, they're learning to collaborate.
It was really nice to know how much they were enjoying this camp, and they're with people who are supporting them and are making them feel great about themselves and their differences and their similarities. And I get two kids that are working together and apart and together and apart, so it's an interrelationship as well as a camp and a learning experience.
It's so fulfilling when I get letters. One stands out for me, a boy who was 14 with Asperger's, and we gave him a grant to go to a drama camp. He wrote to us and said, "Dear ACT Today, thank you for letting me belong for the first time in my life." These kids are remarkable. You know, we underestimate them. They're so knowledgeable, they're so capable, and we can change the life of a family, which means changing the life of a community. We're back with Let's Talk Autism with Shannon and Nancy, and we have some very special guests with us today, the playwright and the young actors in the play On the Spectrum at the Fountain Theater in Hollywood, California.
And right now we have Virginia Newcomb. She Hello. Plays Iris in the film, or in the film, in the play.
Someday, maybe.
Someday. See, it was prophetic.
That's right. That's right.
Just putting it into motion. But you play Iris.
Correct.
And we've been talking about the arc of this play and the main characters, this young man who's on the spectrum, and he is, quote unquote, able to pass at times.
Right.
Iris, not so much. She's more profoundly affected.
And yeah, lower functioning, if you will. And we've kind of understood that her mother just had less resources, mm-hmm. you know. She lives in an apartment by herself, mm-hmm. so everything she's learned on her own. She's mm-hmm. highly intelligent, so
yes.
the juxtaposition between her physical life and her mental life is vastly different.
Yes, which, as we know, many of our young people on the spectrum,
right.
you can't assume non-intelligence because
right.
there's not verbal ability.
She's right. extremely intelligent, and most of what I play, 70% of what I play, is voiceover. So we get to experience Iris's inner world while also watching this difference.
And Iris has started this online presence. Tell us a little bit about what
it's gaming world. It's like a fantasy, online interactive fantasy world. And what she has of it initially in the beginning of the play is just a rudimentary blog. And so she hires Mac to help her do the graphics for it. And that's where
That's how they actually get to meet.
Right.
Yeah.
And she takes a big step and a big, you know, leap to invite him over, too. So that's a big point in the play.
But the disparity between where they are on the spectrum is not apparent until he actually meets her.
Yeah, well, in their individual worlds it is, but their relationship and how they relate to other people isn't until we see them together.
Okay.
And we showed the clip from the play. Within it, there's a moment that was very provocative to me, where your character is talking to the mom of the young man, and taking a very accusatory tone and saying, if you could give him a pill,
would you? Yeah.
And take away his autism, you would, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
And it is that very accusatory tone.
Right. It's almost a challenge because she would.
And Iris is, Iris represents the activism community of autism, which I had no idea how prevalent it was until I started researching this.
And yes.
It's really amazing. I mean, there are blogs, there's countless examples of people stating that belief, this is the way I am. I want to be this way. And even I think that's why it is impactful with Iris, is even as physically rendered as she is, she still is proud of who she is.
Absolutely.
She, of course, has her own vulnerabilities and insecurities like everyone does. But that's her statement. That's her soapbox.
Her attitude is the world needs to adjust to me more than I need to adjust to the world.
Right.
And that's a provocative question, given how prevalent autism has become.
Right.
1 in 88 and now 1 in 50, according to parent surveys.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, this is maybe something as a culture we have to look at. And certainly our education, our workforce needs to look at ways of accepting some of those differences. Clearly.
Well, and maybe just because of working on this character, but my belief system is that it relates to humanity. It relates to how we view people on a day-to-day basis. Yeah. I mean, I feel like that's what this character and what this play gives people the opportunity to open their minds to something different than themselves. And it's, I think, for a lot of people, uncomfortable to watch the character of Iris in the same way that it's uncomfortable to watch anyone with a disability or a difference. Mm-hmm. And so, it's been a constant challenge for me to just keeping it out there, not worry about what people think, not worry about, you know, making people uncomfortable, because that's life. And when we get uncomfortable life, we can turn away in the theater, like, look, take it
right
in.
There. How did you prepare for the role? How did you research it?
In a lot of different ways. Iris is kind of a mix of a bunch of things. We observed at the help group. Mm-hmm. We got to watch Dan and I, which I'm glad he didn't mention because I get to. We got to go to a Valentine's Day dance.
Yes,
which was invaluable. It was it was really beautiful, and he and I both had the same feeling when we walked in, that the sense of freedom in a really interesting way, because there's less judgment. There's the same kind of teenage cliquey stuff, but there's a freedom. They're doing their own thing, and they're not as worried about it, or does, at least seemingly to my neurotypical brain.
No, so this was a Valentine's dance that was just individuals on the spectrum.
Yes, and
interesting.
Yeah, it was really amazing. So that was kind of an entry into it, and then a lot of research online. Mm-hmm. Then some just actory things, like I studied some animals, like a wild horse and a bird, and I've got 50 different things going on. And when I go on stage too with a lot of characters, I feel like the character takes me on, but with Iris, I feel like she comes in and we're kind of doing it together.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's like and I think that kind of helps me relate to the feeling of what it must be like to have those dueling abilities, too, of having that high intelligence and different physical life, is that I have Iris is kind of helping me through it as opposed to taking me over.
when you auditioned for this role, at what point did you hear that it had been originated, the role had been originated by a young woman who's actually on the spectrum? And was that intimidating to you?
It was actually during the audition process, because in researching it, that was the only production that was done. Mm-hmm. So it was a big part of, you know, their publicity for it. So I had learned that, but I have a little bit of experience, not with autism, but with other disabilities in my family. So mm-hmm. being able to, having the opportunity to express that understanding mm-hmm. and being able to kind of use those things that I had knowledge of mm-hmm. has been something I feel like I've been searching for a while. Awesome. So it was the right thing for me at the right time.
Really,
so,
cool.
Yeah.
Tell us about some of the feedback you've gotten from viewers. People have seen yeah. it either that are not on the spectrum or are on the spectrum.
People have been responding really well. I mean, I'm sure there's got to be one person out there somewhere that believes that we're not doing it right, but we've had
maybe not.
Well, hopefully so. We want to reach everyone. We don't bother people as much as we want to.
There you go.
But yeah, we've had a lot of people approach us, and I mean, in tears, just saying how much they relate to what we're doing, and
awesome.
it's the most validation we can have is people with that kind of personal experience being able to communicate that yeah. is. I mean, that's why we're doing this. So, yeah.
And this is sort of a new frontier for mm-hmm. a lot of us as parents, as our children start to get older. You know, they don't stay little forever.
Yeah. Right.
And it's one thing dealing with a cute little toddler or, you know, kindergartner with autism. It's mm-hmm. quite another when that child grows up and has to go out there in the world and mm-hmm. function.
Yeah.
And we're really on the cusp of a lot of those changes. Mm-hmm. And it sounds like this play kind of reflects mm-hmm. that sensibility.
And I feel like that's a universal thing, too. I mean, I know in different ways for autism, but, I mean, mother to, or parent to child relationship and kind of accepting that
yeah.
you know change and going out into the world, it has to be something that we all relate to too mm-hmm. on just yeah. a human level so, mm-hmm. as much as the love theme is, you know. So we hope that if it can resonate with the autistic community, that's fantastic. But what we're finding is that it resonates with everyone.
Yeah,
and
the universal
that's things. The universal aspect of it. So.
Well, such yeah. a pleasure to meet all of
you.
And we're so excited
thank you
about
so much
this
for
project.
Having us.
We really are. And we hope it just has great success and moves on from Los Angeles to other cities.
Absolutely.
And be a movie.
There you go.
Predicted.
I called it first.
Sounds like some great things in store for
yes.
all of you.
Okay.
You're all
well,
very,
you.
Very talented.
Oh, thank you.
Yes.
And,
well,
we look forward to you seeing it.
Okay.
Yes.
I look forward to being there.
All right.
And we're going to come back with more. We'll talk
we're just
going
to come back to close out the show.
Yeah, we'll come
that's
back
about
to close out the show and maybe...
we got to talk a little bit about the run on
oh,
we talked
yes,
about it. We
it
talked
so
about
great.
It slightly on Monday,
okay,
but we got to talk
okay,
about the run.
Great.
So, but thank you so much.
Thank you,
and
thank
we want to remind everybody to go to thefountaintheater.com.
Yes.
And theater spelled R-E, not E-R.
Right.
There it is. Emily's
yeah.
got it for you.
Emily's got it up. Always ready.
And you can check it out.
Yeah.
So stick with us. We'll be back after these messages.
Okay.
Our twins, Justin and Jessica, were premature babies, so we always were very conscientious of their development. But I think it was probably 15 months, Justin started getting really obsessive compulsive with opening and closing doors. And Justin started tantruming a lot too. These would be major tantrums that were just completely debilitating to the family.
Having to take them out of the house, put them in the car, drive around, just to calm them down.
Yeah, I remember a breaking point and just thinking, you know what, we gotta do something, this is not right. Once we were on the track to getting a diagnosis for autism, we started sharing that with our close friends and family. It just so happens that somebody from our older daughter's private school called us out of the blue. She introduced herself and she says, I know that recovery is possible. Those words so early in our journey were a guiding force for us. As we got more educated in knowing what is effective therapies for kids with autism, we realized quality ABA is vital to that progress. That's where we decided that CARD was the right provider for us and for our son. Justin responded very well to therapy. The behaviors were tracked, and we saw that what was being instituted was working.
Justin, what are you doing?
I'm coloring.
You are coloring. Good for you.
There was real progress, and there was progress that was tangible.
I just remember when he made a sentence. He said a sentence. We were just happy about it, going, no way, I can't believe you just did that.
What's the date?
The 18th.
18th of what month?
December.
Oh, what year is it?
2007.
Oh, okay, so how old are you today then?
The therapies that CARD did for Justin didn't just impact his daily living skills, but it was a positive impact on our entire family.
I'm Justin. I am in fourth grade. I like playing video games sometimes. My dream to build a teleporting machine. Like sometimes it's like we're on an airplane and it's like really long. You guys just say, oh, hurry up with that teleporting machine. I'm waiting on you. And I just started Friday Night Lights. This is our third game of the season, and it's pretty fun. You have to be fast.
We attribute so much of Justin's recovery to CARD. Their goal was the same as our goal. We wanted Justin recovered. June 12, 2008 is a day that I celebrate every year because that is the day that Justin was deemed recovered from autism. And Dr. Doreen Granpeesheh met with us, looked at him, and just said, he's brilliant. You need to keep his mind stimulated because he's very smart and he has no residual traits of autism.
Welcome back. We're just about out of time, but I did want to take a second to talk about the amazing run that you guys held on Saturday mm-hmm. in San Diego. The Autism Care and Treatment Military Family
Act Today for Military Families yeah. run and festival.
Yes.
It was our third one. You just saw a segment with Laura Marquand and her recovered child, and Laura really was the leader on this. We, and of course, Amy, who you've met on the show before, my incredible staff. It was the most beautiful day, wasn't it?
It really was a gorgeous day.
And I ran the race. I had done the LA Marathon 2 weeks before, and I was exhausted. I was like, how am I going to get through this little 10K? But I did. It was fun. It was worth it. I ran it for my dad in his Marine hat, and we're going to have the results of the run soon, probably yes. in the next day or two, so we'll let you know how much
money
we raised.
And we took a bunch of video. We were there, and we took
yeah,
a bunch of video.
Yeah, it was great.
You were amazing.
Great.
It was a great event. We're just about out of time, but okay. I want to remind everybody we've got some important guests tomorrow, and I do want to remind everybody, where's my
your
book?
Hat. And
no,
your hat.
Oh, and I got to put that on, too.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm going to put it on as we go out. Okay.
But I want to remind everybody, you need to register for this webinar. There's two of them coming up. It even smells good, Nancy. There's two of them that are coming up on Friday. Yolanda Baker, go to biteyourbills.com. And when you go there, it's a free webinar. You can learn about how you can include your medical expenses on your taxes, even at this late date. So go to biteyourbills.com. We've got some amazing people, the filmmaker of the United States of Autism with us tomorrow, and Rose Morris from the Safety Sleeper, a great thing if you've got a child escaping in the middle of the night tomorrow.
Okay.
So, exciting show tomorrow.
All right. And I will not see you next week. I'm in Sacramento, but
yes.
we may be doing Skype. But
yes,
we'll figure
absolutely.
All that out.
So,
okay.
and we're going to say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Give your kiddos a hug from me.
And make it a great day.
Bye. Bye-bye.